sing together. Hope you had a great week this week. And, just been a very busy week, a lot going on, but God is good. So let's go ahead and sing some praise to Him this morning.
Where I lie, the ransom of presence of my Savior.
Lord, we await eternity, but Lord, while we do, we just trust and lean on you, your precious Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Men, you may be seated. Good morning, and welcome to New Hope Baptist Church. We are delighted that you are here today. Friends, members, visitors, in-laws, outlaws, we're just glad to see you this morning, and trust that you will feel right at church. If you are visiting with us this morning, I want to invite you to fill out the contact card that you will find attached to your bulletin. You can fold it along the perforation that is there. It might seem a little hidden, but it is there. And if you wouldn't mind filling that out, we could have a record of your visit. And if there's anything that we can do for you, please let us know. But we are just honored that you have taken time to be here today. If you are not a visitor, or if you are a visitor, either way, there's a ministry survey there on that contact card, and invite you, if you're in this room, to fill out that survey. Perhaps we can get a little clearer understanding of how we're doing some of what we do here at New Hope. But you, if you don't mind taking the time to do that, you can do that in about, 10 minutes while Brother Tony's preaching. Or maybe not. But you can just put that in the offering plate at the end of the service, if you would, please, and we would appreciate that. But we're so happy about being here this morning and what God is going to do at this time. Right, Justin? Are you happy to be here, Justin? Okay. So he's the youth pastor. You have to understand they're a little off all the time, so that explains that. We are going at this time to dismiss Children's Church. So if you have any children that are up through about third or fourth grade and would like to go to Children's Church, it is through that back corner where you see all the children going in a calm, orderly, quiet fashion. If you haven't been to Children's Church, you're welcome to go back there and see what the kids are doing. You're welcome to go back there and help if you'd like. We have a great children's program. And they'll be having a class back there. And while they're doing that, I'm going to invite the pews to come up to the platform. All of them that are brave are going to come up here. This is the pew family. And we just enjoy so much having this pew family here. And I know it's difficult to get around and meet everybody. So we're not going to try to introduce everybody to you this morning. But just to introduce to you the pew family. And remember to pray for them, but they're an active part of New Hope. We appreciate them. And Matthew is going to lead us in our Bible reading this morning. So if you're able to, if you would please stand, as is our custom for our Bible reading, and he'll be leading us in that.
Behold, we are servants this day, and for the land that thou gavest unto our fathers to eat the fruit thereof, and the good thereof, behold, we are servants in it.
Amen. And let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Word of God that we have in our possession. We thank you that we can come to this place and assemble together with other believers and be encouraged or challenged or convicted or whatever we need. And pray that our hearts would be sensitive to the message as it goes forth this hour. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated.
And sometimes you just need a little talk with Jesus, right?
You've got the high school shirt on. Come up here. There we go. You've already been on stage or about to go on stage, so either you're used to it already or you're practicing for. There we go. Well, I did not know that you were great. Thank you, brother. And so, name and where you went to school? Paige, Ms. Paige. Trinity Christian. Cam from Trinity. Becca from Alden High School. Keith from Warren City High School. Josh from Warren City High School. So these guys are graduates this year. All we want to do this morning is we want to pray for them. This is one of those times in life where you experience a new normal. And regardless of where they're going after this, if they're going to college, if they're going into the workforce, what's going on in their life, they are going to experience a brand new normal. And so what we want to do is we want to pray for them. We want to pray for God's leadership in their life. Also, as a fellow believer, we want you to be a part of their new journey. And because it's difficult, once you start making decisions for yourself and buying your own toilet paper, eventually it starts getting difficult and life starts getting real, and you start making some decisions for yourself that are important, and you have to even decide whether or not the God that you've been told about is your God or is mom and dad's God. And so you have to think honestly about some of those things, and we want to be an encouragement to them, and we want to we want to pray for them, so I want to encourage you to do that. Also to be a testimony for them and to show them that there are some very real things about the Christian life. And so if you would pray with me together, we're going to offer them, if they want to go with me, to eat after church, I'll buy their meal. If your parents want to go, they can buy their own meal. They're grown ups. But y'all welcome to go with me to eat after church. And let's pray for these guys, if you would. Lord God, we love you. We thank you so much for opportunities. We thank you, Lord God, for successes in life. We know the proverb says that the desire accomplished is sweet to the soul. We thank you, Lord God, for the accomplishment that is represented here on this platform, the study, for the hard work that's been put in. Lord, we also understand and acknowledge the hard work that is ahead. Lord, we just ask you to lead and guide them every step of the next part of their lives. Lord, whether it be higher education, whether it be the workforce, whatever it might be, Lord God, I just pray that you would guide, that you would direct. Lord, that the steps they take would be steps that lead them to life in you and to your purpose for their life. Help them to see the importance of you. Help them to see your plan. Help them to know, Lord God, that you have a perfect plan for their life. Lord, I just pray for their strength and their wisdom. I pray for their families. May you guide and direct in your precious Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Give them another hand if you would. All right, Nehemiah chapter number 9. We're continuing with this concept of freedom. We have a gift for you guys after church, so don't run off. With this concept of freedom, and Nehemiah chapter number 9 gives us an interesting perspective about freedom. And Nehemiah is talking to people. I don't know how much you know about the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah has been sent to rebuild the wall. Nehemiah is a cupbearer for a wicked king. And the entirety of Israel is under captivity. They're in slavery again because of their sin. But Nehemiah has been given permission to go and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And as they rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, as they're completing this task, Nehemiah is kind of giving them a history. He's talking about how God is going to restore the people to freedom, and how that that this is a wonderful mercy of God, but what he does is he recaps why they are where they are. why they and how they got in the position where they are. Look, if you would, in Nehemiah chapter number 9 and verse number 36. Let's read that again. Appreciate the pews coming up and reading our scripture reading for us. The Bible says, "Behold, we are servants this day, and for the land that thou gavest unto our fathers to eat the fruit thereof and the good thereof, behold, we are servants in it." Nehemiah says, remember back with Abraham in the book of Genesis, where God tells Abraham, come out of your country and come to a place that I'm going to show you, a land that's flowing with milk and honey, and there's going to be this people, and I'm going to be their God, and they're going to be my people, and they're going to serve me, and we're going to have this relationship together. Remember the land that God gave them, the land of promise, the land that is a picture of the victorious Christian life, this life of freedom and success in Christ. Remember that land that God gave us? Now we're servants in it. Now we are slaves in a land where God said we could be free. This is a voluntary servitude. He's saying we are servants in a land where we shouldn't be servants. We're servants in a land where, that we were given. This is our land. This was given to us by God, and yet we're servants in it. Why? What causes us? Why is the average Christian? How many Christians today, when we sing, "Oh Happy Day," how many of us feel like, "Oh Happy Day"? And how many of us feel like, "Oh Happy Day"? What is the difference? The difference is true freedom in Christ to live that Christian life the way He said we can live it, and this idea and this feeling that the world has us captive. And it's knocking us around, and it's controlling us. One of my favorite verses, and if you've come to my office over a situational thing that's controlling you, you've probably heard me quote this verse for you from the book of Acts, where the Bible says, "None of these things move me, neither counted I my life dear to myself that I might finish my course with joy." It's one of those verses about Christian liberty and freedom, where the Bible says the Christian does not have to be controlled by their circumstances and their situations. You don't have to do that. Brother Tony, you're just not living in the real world, man. There's situations that just, sometimes they just control you. For example, your dad was hit by a truck last week in a head-on collision. How do you control that? You should have been there to see it. Odds are, they're watching on live stream right now. "Hi, Dad. Should have seen my dad last week in the emergency room witnessing the people that even were responsible for the collision. And telling people, hey, God works all things for the good. Those who know Him, those who are called according to His purpose." Amen. As opposed to bellyaching, "Oh, I can't believe I got hit by a truck." I mean, this dude literally hit by a truck. That's not a metaphor. Somebody crossed over. We're talking 12 to 16 weeks minimum. A miracle be alive. What is the difference between somebody who every situation in life controls? I've seen people be controlled over getting a bad meal at a restaurant. And they just rerouted their whole day. What is the difference? Why are Christians in captivity? They don't have to be. It is voluntary slavery in a land where God said you can be free. I want to give you today the mindset that enslaves Christians. Because that's what Nehemiah's doing. Nehemiah's saying, in the land that we were given to be free, we're servants in it. And he recaps the history of Israel. So that's what we're going to do today. Just three basic things that cause Christians and the Bible says that the Old Testament was written for our learning, so we're going to learn from that today. How that there's this unnecessary slavery in our life. First of all, number one, what is the mindset that leads to voluntary slavery? Let's look at this. First of all, promises that we won't act on. When God says you can have and can be this, and we immediately begin to make excuse, you're going to be a slave to that. In other words, if I tell you you can have $20 one time, and I don't do this anymore because There are too many of you who were here before, and you know the trick, and I lose $20. Don't do it anymore. One time during an invitation, as an example of God's free gift of salvation, I said, here's $20 if anybody wants to come get it. And this entire auditorium looked at me like I had a frog on my head. And I said, nobody here needs $20? Nobody wants $20? If you want $20, come get it. So, yeah, a lot of you are here. You remember. $20? It took us a little while. Finally, I coaxed somebody into it. In what parallel universe you got to coax somebody into coming to get $20? In the same way, our Lord and Savior gives us promises in His Word, and we're like, that won't work. And we're staying right there in slavery, unnecessarily, when God says, you can be free. I want you, if you would, to look at how it works. Numbers chapter number 13 and verse number 27. And they told him and said, now this is when the children of Israel first get to the land of promise. We're going to back up from the time before there were judges, the time before there were kings, the time before they took full possession of the land of promise. Look at what the Bible says. This is when they went to spy out the land before they were ever fully in the land, or they had ever taken the land. They went to spy out the land. Here's what the Bible says. And they said unto him, when the spies came back, they said, we came to the land, whether thou sent us. Because why? God said, you can have it. This is yours. Congratulations. This is your land. This is the land of promise, the land that I am giving you. There's going to be some fights, but I'm going to fight your battle. Remember the land of promise. The same promise God is making you about freedom. Today, about Christian freedom, about living a life of freedom. And they came back and they said, surely it does flow with milk and honey. And this is the fruit thereof. You'll remember that from Eshcol they brought back grapes that were so big that two grown men had to bring them on a pole. One cluster of grapes. Two men had to bring those grapes on a pole between two of them. That these are the grapes of Eshcol. Surely what you told us about the land is true. It's a land that flows with milk and honey. Verse number 28. Nevertheless. Boy, now it starts already. Nevertheless. What does the word nevertheless tell us? Nevertheless is a word that indicates to us self-rule. God says, here's what I want you to do. They go in to spy out the land. They said, yeah, we know that that's your plan. Nevertheless. So when you substitute self-rule for God's rule, that is voluntary slavery that is not necessary in your life. God said, do it. I can't do it. I'm not doing it. Remember you were trying to teach your kids that water was okay? You're standing at the pool telling them to jump in? I just jump. I will catch you. It'll be great. And they're like, taste it. Last night I did a wedding. They had green beans at the wedding. My successor did not have green beans. My son. I traumatized that child over green beans. I told him one day, you eating green beans today, you at least going to taste it. I put that child in a headlock. He rolled in the floor, flopped around. And it's amazing how God said, look, there's some good things in life. I'm not saying green beans are one of them, but I'm just saying that it's amazing to me how God has given promises to His believer, and He has to headlock us because we won't submit to the promises He gives us. Just put you in a headlock and pop one in there. You still won't taste it. You ever see your child taste something that you know is good? And they're like, I don't like it. I'm like, touching it to the tip of your tongue is not a taste. Doesn't constitute tasting. And that's the way we, nevertheless, we went over there, and yeah, it flows with milk and honey. Nevertheless, we're not doing that. We're just not doing it. That is us saying, we won't accept God's promises. Let's continue reading that same verse, verse number 28. The people are strong. Here's another thing that forces us to be in bondage unnecessarily. That is earthly perception. What is the earthly perception that causes most Christians to be in bondage? God tells us that there are certain things that lead to our freedom, and he promises us that we'll have freedom, and then we look at it, and we're saying, no, that's going to be too hard. So many Christians say, look, I just can't do it. There's a workout video, probably like me, you own a bunch of them. Workout video that I owned one time, used it, enjoyed it. Anyway, the first part of the workout video says this. Don't worry about trying to work out. Forget the workout part. Just agree to do this. Get ready. Come in the room. Lock the door. Start the video. There we go. Amazing how that works. Christian life, same way. We worry about all the stuff we can't do. Can't do it. The people are strong. They are going to wear us out. We cannot win. So many people don't play the game of promise because they look at it and say, we can't win. We already know we're not good Christians, so we're not going to try. God says, all I need you to do is act in faith. Give me the chance to win the victory for you. The greatest battle recorded in biblical history was won by the worst warrior. The king himself said, you are but a youth. This man is a warrior from his youth. The king said, you cannot win. The other soldiers said, you cannot win. You don't even have any armor. Put this armor on. He said, no, I'm not wearing that. You're ill-equipped, you're too small, you're too young, you cannot win. They said, well, we'll just have to see. The earthly perception is something that causes us to be a slave unnecessarily. Nevertheless, the Bible says, the people are strong that dwell in the land, the cities are walled and very great, and moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. If you'll skip down to verse number 32. The Bible says, and they brought up an evil report in the land, and they were, and they had searched out unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search out is a land that, here's what they said, eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw were men of great stature. And there we saw the giants. Here's something else that will cause you to be a slave. You don't have to be a slave. Fear. Fear. What is fear? Fear is what you think is going to happen that you have no idea is going to happen. That's what fear is. Fear is what you think might happen if you don't do something else. You have no idea that that's true. When, for the longest time, I wouldn't ride anything at Six Flags. When I was young, I'd never been to a big theme park. Looked good on the pictures. When I got there, they were way taller than the pictures. I was just like, I'm not doing it. You're scared, aren't you? A little bit. Right? I mean, listen, everybody's screaming. Good indication. Right? I walk in there, everybody on every ride screaming. They're tall. That's a long fall. I don't know. The fear, reasonable or not, is a thought that something may happen that you have no idea what really happened or not. And so here the children of Israel had this fear that something might happen, and they allowed it to keep them a slave. How many things in your Christian life have you not done because you're scared it won't work? How many things in your Christian life have you not done? I can't teach Sunday school class. I can't share my faith. I can't let anybody know I'm a Christian. I can't, whatever it is, because you're scared to death what might happen that won't happen anyway, because God's going to take care of it, but you're a slave to your fear. A lot of people, I can't even read my Bible. I can't pray. I can't, we have no idea. We've never even tried because we had to step on the battlefield. God said, I'm going to win this great victory for you. I'm going to give you this freedom of the Christian life. But you look at it like, man, that is a huge task. I don't think I can accept that promise. There's this fear. They said the giants are there. And listen to what the Bible says at the end of this verse, verse number 33. And we were in our own sights as grasshoppers. Here's another thing that will keep us all slaves. Self-perception. Self-perception. Who you think you are. What you think you can't do. Listen, guys, in Christ, you in Christ, Andrew Jackson said, you and God make a majority. You can do what God has said you can do. One of the best things ever happened in my life was when I first realized that what God has said I can do, I can do. And what one person can do, I can do. Through Christ, I can do it. Now, I might look a fool doing it the first couple times. I remember the first time I spoke, Dad called and said, I'm sick, I need you to preach for me. I'd never preached, didn't have anything ready. It was on Wednesday night, and I stood behind the pulpit, and my knees was hitting one another. I felt like Belteshazzar in the Book of Daniel, where his loins got loose. It lasted about 15 minutes, consisted mostly of, But don't know. You know what? If you believe something, what one person can do in Christ, you can do. It's your own self-perception that caused you to be a slave to not receiving God's promises. And you end up being a slave in the land that God has given you to be free. Listen, when my wife finally did guilt me into getting on a ride at Six Flags, I was like, hey. That was pretty cool. And then about a year later, I rode him with my eyes open. And it was a whole other ride. Like, that's even cooler. And then I started to stop white knuckling in the bar. And I was like, hey, woo-hoo. And I got old. I was like, I'm not getting on that. That's a realistic fear there. But the point is, listen, you and I end up being a slave when we don't accept the promises, when we won't act on the promises that God gives us. Number two, we are slaves in a land where God said we can be free when there are commands we won't obey. What are the commands? You'll remember in Joshua, now Nehemiah chapter number 9, here's what Nehemiah says. Nehemiah says they took strong cities, they possessed the land, they finally did come in, they took this land of promise. They possessed his house full of goods, wells digged, vineyards, olive yards, fruit trees in abundance. They did eat and were filled. They became fat and delighted themselves in your great goodness. There was this land of promise. It was everything God said it was going to be. Here's that word again. You may recognize it. Nevertheless, they were disobedient. Nevertheless, they were disobedient. It was that disobedience which caused them to be slaves. Unnecessarily, they were slaves where they could have been free. And our disobedience would do the same thing. Now, Joshua tells them, gives them three basic areas where they need to be obedient. And said, listen, if you're not obedient, you're going to end up being in a bind. You're going to end up being a slave in the land that God's given you. And they did not listen. Here are the three basic areas. You'll find it in Joshua chapter number 24. This verse is popular for the verse that you may have hanging up in your kitchen or in your living room somewhere where it says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. This is Joshua chapter 24. And Joshua is telling the people, so listen, here's some things that will enslave you if you're not careful. He says in verse number 13, Joshua 24, 13, and I've given you a land. Who was the land supposed to go to? These people. It was their place, these people. It said, listen, I want you to drive these people out. I want you to drive the inhabitants of the land all the way out. Don't want any left. I want them gone. The first command was this command of separation. on a complete separation. I want you to be complete from, completely separate from them. He says in Joshua chapter number 24 and verse number 16, and the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods, and for the Lord is our God. He it is that brought us out of the land, and our fathers out of the land of Egypt. See the separation? He said, I want you to come out of the land of Egypt. I want there to be a separation. Imagine, if you would, during World War, during the Great War, where a Jewish family who just happened to be great friends with Esau. Can't imagine, because it's an oxymoron. Can't have it. Can't be the same. It's what the Bible talks about in the book of Romans, where light cannot have a relationship with darkness, because when light shows up, darkness is gone. And the Bible, Joshua's telling the people, said, listen, this land is for you, but if you don't have this separation between good and bad, evil and righteousness, if you don't have a separation in your life, you accept that evil in there, you don't keep that command of holiness. Even today, we start a new membership class today. Every time we've ever started a new members class, we've had this same conversation. The hypocrisy. You know what hypocrisy is? When people come to church and claim that they do right, and they go home and they do wrong. And it hurts the cause of Christ. When I come to church and sing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, and I go out and I live like I'm the devil's first cousin. And people are like, I just saw you in a church. And you were worshiping the Lord, and you were talking about all this good stuff and acting like this was who you are. And then you go out here, and I couldn't find Christ in you at all. What happened? Will the real you please stand up? So we see this separation. We see also this idea of service to the Lord. Notice, if you would, and by the way, people tend to enslave us. See, here's what the people really did when they got in the land of promise. They didn't drive everybody out. What they did was they did two things. One, they married them. Made them part of their family. What's the idea there? Here's how people enslave us. Instead of us saying, listen, I'm not going to hang out with that group. I'm not going to be a part of that group. I'm not going to accept that in my life. What we say is, I'll change them. I'll do good, and I'll just change them. That's what children of Israel did. They married them. They said, we'll just make them like us. We'll make them part of our family. That is not what happened. Ask Solomon. Ask any number of people. Where they married someone and they became who that person was for the negative and not for the good. You're not going to change somebody. People enslave us. Evil company corrupts good testimonies, good manners, good works, the Bible says. And so the first thing we try to do is we'll just change them. Here's the second way people end up enslaving us. They said, well, here's what we'll do. If we don't marry them and change them to be like us, we'll control them. They said, we'll make them do all the heavy labor and we'll tax them. We'll control them. You're not going to control evil. You're not going to change evil. Evil's evil. I had a situation not long ago where let me sum it up for you. I was helping somebody with something and they were looking at purchasing something, and the person did that was trying to sell it to them was lie. And so I said, well, we're going to make this decision based on this. Let me just tell you this. First of all, let me kind of tell you where I'm coming from. I'm really not going to be able to take your word for it. Why not? Because the first thing you did was lie. And liars lie. What liars do? Well, I'm not going to lie to you. That's exactly what a liar would say. I ain't mad at you. But if we're going to start this whole relationship off with a lie, you and I just went sideways. And this is why there needs to be this separation between right and wrong. That's why this whole Christian concept of little white lie and all this business, That stuff just has to go. Identify evil in my life. You need to identify evil in your life as something that needs to go, as the enemy in my life. And then it goes from that to, I can't control it. I need to get rid of it. That's the answer. I can't control it, and I can't make friends with it. And so not just that, not just the separation concept, but the service concept. He said also, verse number 14, now therefore fear the Lord, serve him in sincerity and truth. Because a lack of clear direction will enslave you as well. He said, not only does there need to be this separation, there needs to be a service. Who are you going to serve? He ends up telling the people, choose you this day whom ye will serve. What's your life about? Who are you serving? Because a lack of direction in my life will enslave me. Remember when my kids were young, like, can we go long with you? What are you going to do? Don't know. Negative on that. Why not? A lack of direction enslaves us. There's trouble coming right there. We're not going to get in trouble. You just got done telling me you don't know what you're doing. Won't be taking your word for it. And that's how we are as believers. When a believer says, hey, what is your life about? Well, the least you can do is Google it. We're in the information age. You talk about high school seniors. I had a high school senior one time. So, Brother Tony, you know, I'm going to college, but I really don't know how to decide what to do. The average college student changes their major 5 times before they graduate. It's weird, isn't it? Asking somebody who can't keep their room clean to decide what they're going to be when they grow up at 18 years old. So, you know, they don't know what their favorite card is. You know, and we're asking them what their whole life goal is. So here's how we do it as believers. Romans chapter number 12. What we do is we first commit our way to the Lord. We commit our life to Him. And let Him direct our paths. Trusting the one who knows more about us than we know about us. How many times have you done something in life and thought that's really what you wanted, only to find out later it was not? And there's just some real benefit to serving the Lord and having that direction in our life. Do that all day. Lastly, as far as this, what does God want us to do and commands? The singleness of heart. He says this, Now therefore fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and truth. Put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt and serve the Lord. If it seem evil to you to serve the Lord, then choose you the day who you'll serve. Not just service, but this singleness of heart, not being distracted one way or the other. You ever been driving down the road and see something interesting over here? And you kind of start looking at it, and before you know it, you hear a pea growl. Right? God forbid your wife is with you. Because it's like me. My wife thinks she saves my life every time she's with me. I wouldn't have been with you, would have had a wreck. I drive all the time by myself. But when you're not watching here, you're watching here, you'll end up driving over here. Why? That if you don't have this singleness of heart, you can end up being a slave to what you are looking at, what you are desiring. So Joshua basically says, listen, there needs to be this separation between good and evil. There needs to be this idea of what you're serving in this life. There needs to be the singleness of heart. Lastly, so the first thing is what keeps us a slave: promises that we won't act on, commands that we won't obey, and lastly, ruts that we will not get out of. Ruts in our life that we won't get out of. There are some things that just enslave believers and non-believers alike. One of them are just ruts. This is just how we've always done it. And it becomes something that just holds us captive. Oh, Brother Tony, that's just how we've always done it. How many times have you ever heard somebody say, well, that's just how I am? Well, dude, change. You can. If you want to, it could be difficult. But change. Get out of the rut. A rut is a grave with the ends knocked out. Get out of the rut. The key to growth? Because there are two reasons that people change. One is they have to. They have to. Every day, doctors tell people, change or die. Time magazine said somewhere around 20% of people actually do. That's how hard it is to change, by the way. Doctors tell people, change or die. About 20% of people actually make a change, doctors say make a change. But the second reason that people make change is because they're in the habit of growing in their life. This is one of the great things about being a Christian, is that it puts us into the mindset, to the habit of growing and just doing things differently. Lord, you tell me where to go, what to do, I do it. Doesn't matter if I like it, doesn't matter if I understand it. Lord, I will be what you've called me to be. I'll go where you call me to go. Where you lead me, I'll follow. What you feed me, I'll swallow. Amen. I'll just be what you called me to be. And here's what happened in Nehemiah. And we'll go through this just real quickly and we'll close. Nehemiah chapter 9. I want you to write down Nehemiah chapter number 9, verse number 26 through verse number 37. If you're taking notes, and I know a lot of you are on YouVersion, so you're probably not taking notes. But there are four words I want you to take note of if you're actually taking notes and writing it down. Nehemiah chapter 26 and 27, the Bible says that the children of Israel did wrong. And God sent them, let their enemies come in, and here's the word I want you to write down, vex. The children of God, their enemies vexed them. What does that mean? It basically means that they didn't really like what the enemies were doing. They didn't have control over them. It's just they were just kind of a pain. You ever been eating outside? At the wedding rehearsal, they had crawfish. Nothing attracts flies like crawfish. So you're eating and swatting. They didn't control me. It just vexed me. Did I enjoy my crawfish? Yes, I did. Did I enjoy the flies? No, I did not. Didn't ruin my meal. Didn't even really make my meal unpleasant. Just kind of vexed me. The Bible says that the children of Israel, they did wrong, and the enemies vexed them. So much so, finally, that the children of Israel said, God, would you please handle these people? And God did. That's awesome. But look what happens in verse number 28. The Bible says, then after they had rest, they did evil again. What happened then? Then the enemies came in and had dominion over them. That's different. The flies didn't have dominion over me. What's going to happen in the slide to slavery goes like this. First sin just kind of, that's irritating. I don't really like it. The second thing that happens is, I'm dominated. In other words, it's not like I'm always dominated. It's just like, you know, the enemy's starting just to kind of have some victories. But here's what we say. Hey, you know what? You can't win them all. That would say nobody's perfect. You can't win them all. Sometimes you just have those besetting sins you just can't handle. There begins to be this domination in our life. And I become, the word is, dominated. But then they pray. God delivers again. And after they had rest, the Bible says in 30 and 31, the enemies come back and they are given over to them. Now all of a sudden, it just doesn't seem like I can win. But Tony, it doesn't seem like I can win for losing. Seems like, I don't know, man. I mean, it seems like I see the potential for freedom and liberty in my life. It just seems like I can't win for losing. The Bible says that they were given over to their enemies. But hey, they knew right where to go, didn't they? They cried out to God. Until verse number 36 and verse number 37, when we get back to our text verse. Where finally God said, that's it. I'm not answering that prayer anymore. Nehemiah writes, behold, we are servants this day in a land where we ought to be free. And that's that cycle. Because why? Because I just refuse to get out of the rut. And that rut just gets deeper and deeper. I doubt very seriously you've lived in East Texas very long without getting stuck. that wheel gets stuck and you start spinning. You think to yourself, maybe I can rock my way out of it. You put that vehicle in reverse, back it up, go forward, back it up, and you spin the wheel, and all you're really doing is getting deeper, 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 until what, before you know it, you got an axle on the ground, and you're not getting out. Not by yourself. Listen, guys, here's the real truth about it. As the musicians come, God did not intend for you to be a slave in this life. But what sin does and what forsaking the promises of God does is it puts us in a rut that ultimately we can't escape from. And then we just begin to accept it. Hey, that's just what it is, man. And we start just rut living. That's what the armies of Israel were doing when David got there. So they would call that trench living. They'd become comfortable for over a month living in a trench instead of fighting the enemies that God said they could fight to win the victory. And I have a question, same question God asked the man at the pool of Bethesda. Will you be made whole? Do you want to be free? Because God gives us some promises where he says we can. We accept the promises. Follow the commands. Am I willing to get out of rut? Am I willing to get out of that rut that just keeps getting me deeper and deeper? Or am I going to choose to be a slave? As we stand together, let's pray. Lord God, I just pray that today that you would help us to be determined to get out of the rut. Stop just doing those things which we've always done. We've always just been comfortable doing. And look at that which you've told us we could have. And follow the commands that you've given us to get to that place. Lord, we know that the first city in that land was huge, that the people were huge. But Lord, we also know that there is no problem in this life bigger than you. Lord, we see what you were able to do. We see how you gave them freedom. We see, Lord, in our own lives how you've given us freedom. Lord, beginning with salvation and carrying us right on into Christian liberty, I pray, Lord God, that you would help us to embrace the promises and commands that you have for our freedom. Lord, if there's something today we need to come down and take another step, Lord, I pray that we do that on the first note of the first song, your precious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's go.